May it please the court. My name is Margaret McLean for the plaintiffs. I'd like to reserve 3 minutes, please, for rebuttal.
Just keep an eye on the clock.
Will do. Now, this is a case about Google's Android lockbox program, which the Committee on Antitrust described as a covert effort to track real-time data on the usage and engagement of third-party apps. And this included specific usage data that enabled Google to track not just which apps a user had, but also how frequently they use the apps and for how long. And in certain other cases, to go even further and to track also specific searches and other actions that users took within these apps. And so plaintiffs are Android users who have brought claims arising out of this conduct. I'd like to focus on two in particular. On the one, the invasion of privacy claims, both common law and constitutional, and then on the other hand, the breach of contract claim. As far as the privacy claims, the district court correctly concluded that plaintiffs did have a reasonable expectation of privacy in their usage information about third-party non-Google apps based on Google's own representations in the privacy policy, but it nonetheless dismissed the claims on the finding that Google's conduct was not highly offensive. And for the district court to draw that conclusion as a matter of law at the pleading stage was error.
Can I ask you about the privacy policy? Because it says that they'll collect information about activity on third-party apps that use our services and information about apps that you use to access services. And the court thought that it was, I think the term he used was counterintuitive to think that services would mean the Android operating system itself, but it's defined in the in the policy to include the Android operating system. So why under the plain reading of the terms of the policy, what wasn't there a disclosure that they would collect exactly this kind of information?
Sure. Your Honor, in other places in the privacy policy itself, Google uses the specific language Android device with Google apps. It does that in two places, at least. It does it at ER 32, and it does it in even more detail at ER 53, where there's a specific additional context, little blurb about use of Android device with Google apps, again, implying that there is also an Android device without Google apps. If all apps are Google apps on an Android device, then it's redundant and unnecessary to talk about an Android device with Google apps. It even gives an example. This is again on ER 53. It says these devices, the Android devices, use Google Play services and other pre-installed apps that include services like Gmail, Maps, your phone's camera, and phone dialer, et cetera. Which again, this is giving not just an impression, but a clear message that there is still such a thing as a Google app and a non-Google app, even in the context of using an Android device.
Well, there is a Google app and a non-Google app, and there is also Google apps on non-Android devices, right? Like I think I have a Google app on my iPhone or something. But those do exist. Those things do exist. I'm not sure how that over. I mean, I think in order, you would have to say that reference is meaningless, I guess, to make the argument that it be superfluous or. Is that your point?
Yes. What would it mean to say an Android device with Google apps if necessarily all Android devices have only Google apps by their nature, by the virtue of the fact that it's on an Android device? If that transforms everything into a Google app, then it doesn't make sense to talk about Android devices with Google apps or to talk about or to give examples of what might be a Google app on an Android device if all apps are magically Google apps when used on an
Android. Apps aren't Google apps, but the operating system itself is a service. I mean, you would agree that the privacy policy says that, right?
I do, but I would make two points about that. In the bullet just underneath where it says platforms like the Chrome browser and Android operating system, this is on ER 30, it references products that are integrated into third-party apps and sites like ads and embedded Google Maps. So again, that's giving you the impression that an app, a third-party app that uses our services, is something that has an actual Google product embedded into it, a map or a Google search bar, something of that sort. It's not covering all apps used in all ways.
Yeah, it seems like, you know, if I assume that you're right about all that, then basically what you're saying is the privacy policy in one place says that Google, that the Android operating system is a Google service, and then says it'll track things on these on Google services, and then elsewhere it talks about actual Google apps as and says we'll be tracking things on those too, but it's not clear that those two things are inconsistent. It could be redundant, I suppose, but there's not an inconsistency. Do you think there's an inconsistency? And if there isn't, do you think that just the redundancy itself is enough to show to district court judges turn it somehow makes it counterintuitive, I guess?
I would say both, Your Honor. I would say I do think the redundancy in and of itself at least raises an ambiguity. So obviously, we try to construe contracts so as to give meaning to all of their terms, and that doesn't happen if you have Google Apps being something else. But again, even just the use of the terms Google Apps and then third-party apps and services like ads and embedded Google Maps, again, they're giving examples. They're meant to be representative examples. That's like a Google product that is actually embedded into it that says a recognizable Google thing on it, not just all apps by virtue of touching the Android operating system. Another point I would raise on this is at ER 31, it says, we collect information about the apps, browsers, and devices you use to access Google services. Now, if you're talking about Android as a Google service in that sense, it doesn't make sense, right? You don't use an app to access Android. It's the other way around. It's the Android operating system that allows you to access an app. So I would argue at a very minimum, there's ambiguity about whether Android is meant to constitute a Google service in the context of these app discussions.
I mean, but doesn't that just reflect the fact that this is a policy? Like, if this were the Android privacy policy, that would seem like a stronger argument for you. But this is a policy. This is a general policy that covers Android, covers other kinds of things. So maybe it makes a little bit less sense as applied to Android. But doesn't the breadth of applicability of the policy kind of account for why maybe it's a little bit awkward in some of its applications?
I would argue that could cut the other way as well, Your Honor, that the fact that it is a general policy and it's not making clear what the effect is of using apps on an Android device versus another type of device, that it does have this language that would seem to be contradictory and repetitive, would again raise an ambiguity at a minimum, make it inappropriate to conclude as a matter of law that there's no promise here.
That's kind of why I was asking about the contradictory versus redundant or repetitive. It seems to me that given if you're trying to write a broad policy that applies to Google apps that run on non-Android devices and also Android devices, it seems intuitive to me that there would be some redundancy or repetitiveness perhaps if you're trying to write a global policy that applies to all these different scenarios. Contradictory is a different thing. If it's contradictory, that would seem to be more troubling. I'm still just not seeing where something is contradictory. I'm seeing where arguably it renders some aspects of the privacy policy arguably superfluous in certain circumstances, but again that or redundant. But that doesn't that's if you're trying to write a privacy policy that's broad and applies to every Google product, then it seems to me that might be impossible not to have some redundancy in there.
Well, but I would respond that it would have been very easy to be clear about the effect of using apps on an Android device as opposed to any other. Could simply have said so rather than saying, it could have said third-party apps and sites or things with embedded services or any app used on an Android device. It would have been a very fixable problem if that were something they desired to do. And Google has indicated in numerous places in the policy that it intends this to be clear, that it intends it to be comprehensive. We understand this is a big responsibility. We work hard to put you in control, and none of that would seem to be coming to bear in the way that they've used Android and apps within this policy.
This is a little different issue, but did the plaintiffs allege that they read the policy before purchasing the devices or relied upon the policy?
Before purchasing their policy, no. But the devices, no. One plaintiff did allege that she read it, but she didn't allege the timing.
She read it at some point.
Correct.
Is all we know from the allegations.
That's one correct.
Okay.
Did you want to reserve
yes,
the rest of your
Honor.
Time? We used up a lot of your time, but we'll give you 2 minutes
Thank you.
For rebuttal.
I appreciate it, Your Honor.
Mr. Berkowitz.
Good morning, Your Honors, and may it please the court. Ben Berkowitz for the appellee, Google. We obviously agree that Google disclosed both that Android was a service and that it collected information about third-party app activity on its services, including Android. I'm happy to answer any questions the court may have. I'm happy to talk about the fraud claims and so forth, but I'd like to use the time in the way that would be most useful for the court.
One thing that you might clarify for me is the argument we were just discussing with your friend on the other side is essentially an argument that the district court's reading of the policy was wrong. And I got the sense from the introduction of the introductory parts of your brief that you did not agree with the district court's reading of the policy, but it wasn't clear to me that you had really developed that as sort of an independent basis for affirming that we might affirm on the ground that the policy meant what was suggested and not what the district court said. So can you sort of, is that an argument that you've preserved here?
We've certainly argued that the collection was disclosed, and I think that spans a number of pages of our brief. That argument goes to two different aspects of the privacy claim. It goes to both whether or not there is an expectation of privacy, and it also goes to whether or not the alleged intrusion is a serious intrusion. And we see the case law, the teachings of the California Supreme Court in Hill and Pioneer, but also this court's precedent in In Re Facebook, consider that aspect in both of those prongs. So, for example, in In Re Facebook, the court looked at the seriousness of the alleged intrusion by specifically examining, specifically examining Facebook's alleged promise in that case not to collect logged out user behavior. Here, obviously, Google made no such promise. It disclosed precisely the opposite. In other words, it disclosed that it was collecting information about third-party app activity. And of course, also unlike In Re Facebook here, this is logged in activity, et cetera. So we've made that argument. We think it's relevant, obviously, to the breach of contract claims, to the fraud claims, and of course, also to the privacy claims.
What is your response to, I don't think the other side disagrees that you do define the operating system as a service, and you do say you collect on data on services. But I think their argument is, but elsewhere you talk about apps running on the operating system, and that would be kind of, put words on your mouth, but redundant. That would be, there's no reason to talk about that because you already told them you're going to be collecting. What is your response to, then that creates ambiguity in the contract. What is your response to that?
Well, I think we need to look at the structure of the contract. So we're kind of looking at provisions in different paragraphs here. So I don't think there's any contradiction. If you look at ER 30, which is the first page of the contract, that's where it defines Android as the operating system. Beginning on ER 31, it says there's a subsection that says information we collect as you use our services. And then it goes on your apps, browsers, and devices. I believe that's the portion that my colleague was reading from. There's no contradiction there. It says we collect information about the apps, browsers, and devices you use to access Google services. If we turn to the very next page, that section goes on to say we also collect information, and here I'm reading at ER 32, the second sentence, we also collect information about the interaction of your apps, et cetera, with our services. We then go on to the next section, which is your activity, which is the language we've cited here. And it says, we collect information about your activity in our services, meaning in Android. The example that's given, I think it's the seventh bullet point, is activity on third-party sites and apps that use our services.
Would you agree, though, that in ordinary language, it's unnatural to talk about an app using the service of an operating system. That's not the way people normally talk about apps, is it?
Well, I think it makes sense in this context. I mean, these are apps that plaintiffs allege they downloaded from the Google Play Store and that they used on the Android operating system. So these were certainly apps that were using Google services in multiple senses. I mean, they were using the Google Play Store, they were using the Android system. The district court, among the district court's findings, as the district court noted, that at no point had plaintiffs alleged that these apps were not using Google services, and in fact, they may have been using additional Google services as well. And I don't believe plaintiffs have challenged that that reasoning on appeal as well. So I think these are apps that are using Google services, certainly in multiple senses.
And if we were to conclude that the agreement or the policy was ambiguous, what would we do?
Well, I think the court would affirm for the reasons that the district court dismissed the claims. And the district court did not grant our motion to dismiss on the basis of consent. The district court granted our motion with respect to the fraud claims because plaintiffs had never read any statement by Google prior to, or don't allege they have ever read a statement by Google prior to purchasing their device. The omission claim because it doesn't go to a central function. Data collection is not a central function of the device. The privacy claims, or I should start with the breach of contract claims. The breach of contract claims because plaintiffs have not identified any promise by Google that was broken, and the privacy claims because both Google did not, unlike in Ray Facebook, Google never disclaimed that it was collecting this information. This is logged in, not logged out information. Google did not engage in, as the Ninth Circuit put it, blatantly deceitful conduct, et cetera. And the only particular pieces of information that are alleged to have been collected with respect to, for example, the size 9 slippers and the extra virgin olive oil are the type of routine commercial behavior that this court and the courts in the circuit have routinely found does not rise to a highly egregious breach of social norms. That's a long way of saying the court can, even if the court were to find this ambiguous, that's consistent with, I mean, the court can still affirm on all of the, for all of the well-reasoned reasons that the district court provided. I see I have 2 minutes remaining, but if the court has no questions for me, I'm happy to
It looks like there are none, so thank you.
Thank you, Your Honors.
A few points. First of all, if the court were to find that the policy is ambiguous, then that would require reversal of the district court's finding that there was no promise. If the court were to find that it was ambiguous as to whether or not Google did promise not to collect app activity in third-party apps or non-Google apps, that would require a reversal.
Why is that? I don't follow that argument, because your argument that it's ambiguous is a way to defeat consent, that it, and they in fact told users that they would be gathering this information. But if they didn't say it clearly enough, how does that mean they made a promise not to do it?
I would say the finding would be that it is not clear whether or not they made the promise, and that needs to be evaluated by the finder of fact, whether to interpret that as a promise. When Google sets out, this is the data that we collect, it's from points A, B, C, D, and E, that it doesn't also include point F that was not clearly explained or disclosed.
I thought the district court's position would kind of boil down to, it's not clear that you've made a promise that you've made clear that you will collect this stuff, but it is clear enough that you haven't promised you wouldn't. It seems that's kind of where the crack that you fell into in front of the district court.
I agree. I think that is the right crack.
And you're saying there's no such crack can even exist, I think, is your argument, right?
It is my argument. If it's not clear, then how can he be so sure that there wasn't such a promise?
So are you saying it was implied in the document? It's not clear?
That is another source of the district court's error, that he dismissed also our alternative quasi-contract claims that would certainly seem to fill that gap, that there is an implication or an understanding created by this document that
have such a claim?
Can we do. We have implied contract claims.
Implied, I know you've alleged it, but is it cognizable when you have an express contract claim?
We have an express contract that, under that reading, doesn't touch on this topic, that doesn't actually promise not to collect from third-party apps if we're going to credit that reading of the contract. But it was error on the district court's part to dismiss both of the claims, to find that neither of them, when they're pled in the alternative for exactly that reason and that purpose. I would just point to one last thing just about the obviousness or not of this on the privacy policy. It is a program called Android Lockbox, right, which implies secrecy, implies they're not being open about it. The Congressional Subcommittee also described it as a covert program. So I would just end with that.
Thank you very much, counsel. Thank both counsel for their arguments in this case, and the case is submitted.